as part of this session. I'm going to be introducing to you the practical, innovative decision support tool, which is resilience.io. But before I start, I really want to extend our sincere thanks to the whole of the Cities Alliance team, who, without them, we wouldn't be here today, and they've really helped in terms of the rollout of the platform. And I also want to thank TFID for the inspiration and funding of the Future Cities Africa program. Sorry, we need to move the slide. So who are we? Who are the Ecological Sequestration Trust? We were set up in 2011, 5 years ago, by the distinguished engineer and city planner Peter Head, CBE. And he set up the organisation to be facilitators, to work in the space in between the private sector and public sector, academia and civil society. And what we want to do is to speed up and scale up transformational change. Essentially, our aim is to help city regions to target investment towards human well-being and the health of the planet. Now, surely everyone here agrees that this is highly relevant to the urbanisation process and making it a success of it. Next slide. I thought I might have a button to move forward. So, as I said, I'm here to introduce resilience.io. What is it? It's an integrated systems platform. Now, what do I mean by this? Essentially what this describes is the functioning of a city and its intellect. So you can imagine, if I can show you this, it describes all of the systems or the sectors that make that city region function effectively. So you can imagine your energy supply system and how it might differ in certain different districts within the city, water supply, waste collection, agriculture, and so on and so on. And so we complete a computer representation of that city region by building these processes. And why that's really important, as you've heard throughout this session, throughout this conference, is this helps us to move away from thinking in silos or thinking in individual projects, because this presents insights in terms of those integrated systems connections. So how does my investment in the water supply system, how does that impact on energy requirements, and what are the CO2 intensity of that? So what's the long-term impact of my investment here? Let me just move on. And then an additional feature to describing the functioning of a city region is understanding the risks and the hazards that might impact on that region, from, for example, flooding, higher intensity rainfall, drought, and so on. And so we're able to understand what is that disruption to your existing city region and to what interventions you might plan to overcome that. And finally, I put this image on the slide in terms of the technical development behind the platform. I only have 15 minutes here, so I can't go into lots of details, but we are part of the World Cafe exercise, so we'd be really happy to talk to you and answer any more questions in depth, and we're going to be at this table here at the front, so we'll look forward to talking to you about that. So what does this mean to you? To build an integrated system or a computer representation of your city region, you would download, and I have to stress this, it's free. It's an open source, open access platform, so you can download this from the cloud, build up a graphical representation of your own city region, begin to populate it with the energy system, housing, water, agriculture, and so on. Begin to populate it with those processes that accurately describe the situation today. And then you can use that to test scenarios. So you'll have consultancies and engineers and so on who are proposing, what about this investment in this engineering solution? You can test that on here, and not just see cost benefit in terms of economic terms, but you can see what jobs are being created, what skills are required to be able to deliver that, what are the knock-on impacts in terms of human health and well-being. So you'll be able to use this very easy, intuitive user interface, which underneath describes the complexity of your city regions, but up front is very easy and easy to access and to use and to use it to test interventions. And so why is this interesting? As I said, it's a practical, innovative tool. It's practical because it brings us out of the sector siloed thinking and enables us to consider courses of action that are integrated system. It's a science-based platform and data-driven. So essentially it's using data and both social and physical sciences to inform policy and decision making. It's evidence for investment, and I'll come on to that in a little bit later. And it also provides support in terms of performance-based procurement or designing your policies and your technology interventions based on performance, not based on the outputs, not based on the numbers of cubic meters of water requirement, but based on what does this do to human health, to well-being, to CO2 emissions, and so on. And finally, it's really practical in that the outputs from this scenario tool will enable you to understand how does this help me and my city or my country to achieve sustainable development goals, to work towards this implementing the Sendai framework or COP21 agreement. And this is a point where it relates to the next speaker, the Gaia Soft platform, in that these metrics can then be used in the knowledge platform to help to manage the implementation of that once you've designed your strategy and your tactics. So moving on, where have we got to within the Future Cities Africa program funded by DFID? Well, within the scope of that, we had the time and the team to be able to build the computer architecture that helps to build that systems model, as well as to demonstrate its use, its functionality, but just by looking at one sector. And so within this building, 18 months ago, 80 or 90 people from across government, private sector, and so on chose water and sanitation as one of the biggest issues of resilience for greater Accra metropolitan area. But the point being is that we could have built this model for energy system or for transportation. We've done it for water and sanitation just to demonstrate the functionality. So what did we do? You'll have a number of questions in your mind, and as I said, we'll be happy to talk about these earlier on, but one of the questions that always comes up is the use of data. So to be able to drive this model, we've used Ghana Statistical Service data to describe socio-economic population, in terms of gender, age, education, economy, and so on. And we've also described those processes that I talked about, so the technology inputs and output requirement for running a water, potable water treatment plant, or for running a plant that develops water sachets and distributes those. So we collected all of that data. We have an expert team of modelers, Imperial College London and the Institute of Integrated Economic Research, who have built the architecture of the model. And at the same time, we worked with an expert team here in the Greater Accra Metropolitan Area. A number of you are in the room, from across government, private sector, academia, and civil society. And this is really important because you can have the evidence, the technical information, to back a particular course of action. But unless it's backed up by the right collaborative approach and government structures to be able to implement those decisions, take those decisions and implement, then the data and so on isn't as effectively used. And then so how is this team using resilience.io? Well, as I described earlier on, as a systems model, you have to draw the systems boundary, and this can be administrative, or it could be water catchment areas, so it could be more physical. Here to describe Greater Accra Metropolitan Area, we'll describe these 15 districts. We collected fine-grained data for those districts. With that information, we then use what's called an agent-based model. And what that's doing is describing a computer representation of the population of the city region. As I said, gender, by gender, by age, and so on. And by running that simulation over a day, over a week, over a year, over 15 years, you can build up these sort of helps to inform this final output in terms of what sort of technologies will help us to achieve those demands. So that's essentially a sequence of how people use this platform today in Ghana. And just to note, as part of this pilot project, we've trained 15 people who have this prototype installed in their laptops. And I'm sure those that are around will be able to talk to you about how they're currently using it to inform policy decisions. It's been very well received. The Deputy Minister for the Ministry of Local Government and Rural Development, also Robert Ansar, who's the Executive Director of GAMA, Accra Metropolitan Area. He says it's a great thing for GAMA, it's a great thing for Ghana, and I believe it will be a great thing for Africa. So we've had some tremendous feedback. People are telling us, we want to use this as part of our role, as part of our jobs. We want to use this type of tool to help to support me in my planning, my policy making, my investment decision making. I wanted to talk very briefly about the results. The early results from our water and sanitation prototype. So firstly, we looked at three use cases. One of them was how to achieve the Sustainable Development Goal 6 for 100% water access to water supply, potable water supply. The second one was 100% access to sanitation systems. And the third one was a review of current and planned investments in GAMA. For example, through the World Bank program, how far are those programs going to take us towards the Sustainable Development Goal implementation? So here, quickly, the water supply sector, we've run the analysis between now and 2025 and understand that the requirements based on the growing population is an additional 200,000 cubic meters of potable water. As I said, it's an integrated systems platform, even though we built the prototype just on water and sanitation, this can tell you, so what are the knock-on effects across and the interlinkages across to other systems. So, for example, the desalination plant investment shows you the electricity demand requirements to meet that population demand for water. Moving on to wastewater treatment. Here's your scenarios in terms of population growth, in terms of the increase in the volumes that need to be treated. That provides you with a series of graphs, and you can imagine straight away these kinds of results fit into your medium-term plans, five-year plans, or business case. So you can demonstrate very clearly and make the case for investment in terms of intervention like this. And then here's your results in terms of benefits of jobs, jobs created, carbon emissions. Now I'm going to move on quickly. What are our next steps? And we'll be really happy to talk about this much more around our table. But we'd love to talk to you about developing one of these platforms in your city region, and in your country. But I'll talk very quickly about the scale up for the model itself for in Ghana and in Africa. So the first thing to mention is we'll take it beyond water and sanitation to all of the sectors. One of the really interesting things we're looking at doing is to connect it to the HAS funding flood risk app that the team are sat here, and they're going to be launching this app tomorrow. So we're looking at how we can look not just at flood risk, but also at disaster risk response and reduction in terms of long-term planning. Just finally to say on that, we're looking at how we can expand it from a city region to a national level model. We'll talk in much more detail. I'm running out of time, but we'll talk in much more detail around, I mentioned this, that the international finance community are telling us that the capital for investment isn't the problem. The availability of capital isn't the problem, but it's the ability to present what's called bankable projects. So how can I present for my city region, projects that are risk reduced and able to attract finance. And so we've developed this Urban Development Investment Fund, which we'll be setting up with the Green Climate Fund, European Investment Bank, KfW, and a number of others, linked to the first prototype here to begin to build new investment into the water and sanitation systems here in Ghana. And the final thing to say is we've developed something called Roadmap 2030. And this presents a scale-up trajectory of how you can use these open source tools, build the capacity, collect the data, use this kind of evidence to attract new investment to achieve the resilience targets that we all have to build inclusive communities and city movements. So apologies, this is a very, very short introduction, and I know some of you know a lot more about this from having worked on it, but I hope I've given you some sense of the innovation and the practical use of this tool, and we'll be very happy to talk in much more detail about it and about how we can develop this platform in your city and your country. So the National Planning and Development Commission put it like this, and I really like this, dream it, plan it, live it. And that's what our platform can help to do.